Consider. You are a Roman soldier, and it is 83 BC. The Republic is in the midst of a civil war. You, in the city of Oximum, on the east coast of Italy, are pledged in loyalty to Gnaeus Pompeius, a young commander who is only 23 years old. And he leads you out, and you begin to march. But as you march, you find yourself surrounded. Three separate armies of the enemy. Your young leader makes the decision to attack one of them. So you get on your horse, and you see that he is on his horse too, riding in the front. And you engage a troop of Celtic horsemen. And in the melee, you see this young Pompeius fighting towards the leader of the enemy, where he fights him, and he kills him. And all the horsemen of the enemy scatter, and you get to track them down and rout them. The other two armies of the enemy, seeing this, flee. You're a Roman soldier in an age of civil war. Your life depends on the prudence and quick decision-making and composure of your general. Little wonder, then, the troops of the enemy come over to him. The towns submit to him. He inspires loyalty through his actions. This is the beginning of that momentum that will lead to the international renown of Pompey the Great. Pompey was a conqueror, and one of his first victories was in Sicily, where he went to track down the remnants of the Marian party, loyal to Caius Marius. And Plutarch may not think too highly of the Marians. He writes, at least based on his word choice here, "About this time news came to Sulla that Perpenna was fortifying himself in Sicily, that the island was now become a refuge and receptacle for the relics of the adverse party." That is just not sympathetic language. So he gets there. So Pompey gets there and he wins. And one of the individuals that was there who was important to be killed was Carbo. And here are the words of Carbo. It is related, by the way, of Carbo, that as soon as he was brought to the place and saw the sword drawn for execution, he was suddenly seized with a looseness or pain in his bowels and desired a little respite of the executioner in a convenient place to relieve himself. You ever heard of that? You get a little bit of a reprieve because you're going to shit yourself. Another bit of an amusing beginning. Do you know how Pompey's father died? He was struck by lightning. And when you think about it, these Romans walking around in these metal plates must have been basically walking lightning rods. And as soon as a thunderstorm crops up, what are you supposed to do? So, he probably shat himself too, actually, come to think of it. Just like Carbo. So after dealing with Carbo, Pompey next has to deal with Domitius, who is another member of the Marian faction, and he has to track him down in Africa near Carthage. Domitius is an early example of Pompey was by all accounts a great general, but he benefited from a bit of luck and the stupidity of the generals he was going up against. In this instance, Domitius, thinking that there's going to be no battle because it's raining, orders his men to return to their tents in their camp. Plutarch says Pompey ordered a march forthwith, and having passed over the torrent, fell in immediately upon their quarters. So what it leaves us to wonder, the extent of this rainstorm and the extent of Domitius' daintiness calling it off for a rain delay. What, do they just trudge across knee-deep water and kill them all? Not impressive. Not every Roman was impressive. And then this next sentence is becoming quite common in these lives. The enemy being routed with a great slaughter. Routs and slaughters. We're seeing a lot of these between the life of Crassus, the life of Pompey, and the life of Sulla. I think we're getting really used to this. The enemy being routed with a great slaughter. It is after a sentence such as that where Voltaire would tack on, satirically, the end segment, in accordance with international law. Because this is just seems to be the end result of just about everything. Here, about 17,000 may well have been killed or captured. From here, Pompey goes to Numidia and conquers a whole bunch of Numidians down there. Perhaps here, the rout and slaughter goes without saying. We don't have to see these words yet again. Now, this is kind of cool, though. He decides to take some time to hunt wild beasts. I mean, this is the paragraph that the wild beasts of Africa ought not to be left without some experience of the courage and success of the Romans, and therefore he bestowed some few days in hunting lions and elephants. Now, here just a note for any animal lover. It is always enjoyable if you go back and read some old writings about the initial impressions that people had of the wildlife on the continent of Africa. They describe a wildlife population that just doesn't exist anymore. If you read Captain Singleton by Daniel Defoe, he will describe long migratory chains of elephants so numerous that they would take up the entire horizon, and that lions, a pride of lions, would be on the move themselves and have to sit there and wait for that whole train to walk past. And there's some description that if any lion tried to sneak past, the elephants would fling them in the air and they would be trampled. It used to be a different place. Anyway, what happens next is Pompey is recalled from Africa back to Rome by Sulla. There's a little bit of drama between the two of them, but Pompey nevertheless gets a triumph. And he is bestowed the great. Pompey the Great he is from now on. He's only in his mid-20s at this point. All right, the next thing that happens is that Sulla dies. When he dies, Lepidus marches on Rome. So this is the Marian party, right? Still alive to some extent. Lepidus decides to move on Rome. And his colleague is a guy named Brutus, who is walled up in the city of Mutina. Pompey marches out to him, lays siege to the city of Mutina, and whatever happens on the inside, Brutus all of a sudden has to surrender himself in person, and Pompey has him killed. Let's take a snapshot of what we're looking at in Italy as of this moment, and Lepidus gets driven out. This little insurrection is defeated very quickly. But just as a snapshot in time, we now have Pompey, one of the greatest men in Rome, in his mid-20s. Julius Caesar is in his early 20s. Julius Caesar is about 22, 23 years old. The Brutus who is killed has a son who is the more famous Brutus. At this moment in time, he's about 7 years old. Mark Antony is 5 years old. All right, I want to skip to these Cilician pirates. These people are pretty cool. If we liked the Parthians, we might like these guys even more. Cilicia is a region in Turkey, but apparently it is disputable what their origins are. They could be something like Greeks, or they could be something like Phoenicians. Who knows? All right. But Cilicia, after Pompey has to go deal with them, is going to be incorporated into the broader republic as a province. The power of the pirates first commenced in Cilicia. Right? This is Plutarch. Having in truth but a precarious and obscure beginning. You know, like we just said, no one really knows anything about these Cilicians. They come to take over the entire Mediterranean. Let's hear this. This is Plutarch's description. They had diverse arsenals or piratic harbors, as likewise watchtowers and beacons all along the seacoast, and fleets were here received that were well manned with the finest mariners and well served with the expertest pilots and composed of swift sailing and light-built vessels adapted for their special purpose. And then here's the other good stuff. Their ships had gilded masts at their stems, their sails woven of purple, and the oars plated with silver, as if their delight were to glory in their iniquity. You know, does Plutarch not think anything's kind of cool? There was nothing but music and dancing, banqueting and revels all along the shore. Plutarch also adds these other lines, like, so they had above 1,000 sail, and they had taken no less than 400 cities. These guys took over. Here's other interesting stuff. They themselves offered strange sacrifices upon Mount Olympus and performed certain secret rites or religious mysteries. Continuing on, Plutarch writes, this piratic power, having got the dominion and control of all the Mediterranean, there was left no place for navigation or commerce. And this it was which most of all made the Romans finding themselves to be extremely straitened in their markets. A bunch of pirates from a small region in Turkey threatened the grocery delivery to the Roman Empire. Jeez. Now, of course, while this episode in history, it only takes up a couple of pages in Plutarch's Parallel Lives, but this was a big deal. If it wasn't a big deal, the powers that were granted to Pompey would not have been. And these are the powers that were granted to him. One of his friends, Gabinus, proposed this law. Here are the lines from Plutarch. Whereby there was granted to him not only the government of the seas as admiral, but in direct words, sole and irresponsible sovereignty over all men. For the decree gave him absolute power and authority in all the seas within the Pillars of Hercules and in the adjacent mainland for the space of 400 furlongs from the sea. Now there were but few regions in the Roman Empire out of that compass, and the greatest of the nations and most powerful of the kings were included in the limit. That's the extent of the power given to him, which obviously serves to show us the trust that there was in Pompey and the reputation that Pompey had. But it also shows us the precariousness of the empire in being reliant on importation of cereal and foods from other regions, that they took this drastic measure. And then next, when we see Pompey's departure, we see Plutarch write, 500 ships were manned for him and an army raised of 120,000 foot and 5,000 horse. 24 senators that had been generals of armies were appointed to serve as lieutenants under him. And to these were added 2 quaestors. Okay. And by the way, this is just an interesting, this is almost a bit of economic trivia here. Now it happened within this time that the prices of provisions were much reduced, which gave an occasion to the joyful people of saying that the very name of Pompey had ended the war. Isn't that amazing? That's, never mind the people's silliness. That's the essence of the futures market. That the name of Pompey inspired so much confidence that the anticipation of a reduction in prices in the future brought about a reduction of prices in the present. This is the nature of speculative economics. Economics is not a science. We always have to remember that. Whenever someone starts talking in jargon, it's all babble. It has to do with our ridiculous anticipations, whether they're right or wrong. Picture a baby with a rattle, or an infant with a rattle. You tell it you're going to take the rattle away, it'll start crying, even though it still has the rattle in its hand. You take the rattle away, but after some time has passed, you promise you're going to give the rattle back. The baby will rejoice, even though it does not have it yet. That is the nature of the markets. A baby with a rattle can pout. A baby without one can gleam with anticipation. We should also mention the fact that with all these senators with him, he must have been a de facto makeshift government. He was a government afloat. Incredible. The scale of his dominions and the legitimacy that having 24 senators around him must have granted him. But what actually happens is actually a little anticlimactic. After all that buildup, you know, the revelries of these pirates and their 400 taken cities and their huge fleet, Pompey divides and conquers and just wipes them out in about 40 days, tracks them down, they flee the seas. He takes over the whole Mediterranean and tracks them down to their homeland of Cilicia, where they built up in a hive, Plutarch calls it. So that episode comes to an end. Pompey just gets even more power. As he gets more power, now we can move on to the next amusing bit of history here, and that is the fate of Mithridates and Pompey in the East. So the government gives him command of all those forces under Lucullus, who's a name that we haven't talked about much yet. But he's a Roman general who's been fighting against Mithridates, the king of Pontus, out in Turkey, as well as Tigranes, the king of Armenia. And Lucullus has been out winning these wars. And all of a sudden, his command is just usurped and given over to Pompey, who's already got plenty of power of his own. So an interesting altercation takes place between Pompey and Lucullus. They don't fight each other. And I like Lucullus. I like how he quits when he's ahead. But they have an exchange, and what Lucullus accuses Pompey of is having no real achievements under his belt, that he arrived in Spain to defeat Sertorius after Metellus had already done most of the work, that he had arrived in Italy to deal with Spartacus after Crassus had done most of the work, and that when he defeated Lepidus, that Catulus had done most of the work. And that's an interesting allegation against Pompey. And if we were to say, but he defeated the Cilician pirates on his own. So has he ever picked on someone his own size, is what we can ask. And something we should remember. Lucullus says this to him and then leaves. It's something to remember because when we do the second part of this Pompey stuff, Pompey is going to have to go head-to-head with Julius Caesar. Is he up to it psychologically? It's going to be a perfectly valid question as we read that. So, that being said, there's this incredible description about a night battle between the Romans and the armies of Mithridates, the king of Pontus. In this night battle, the Romans charge. Here's what he says. The night was not so very dark. Though the moon was going down, it yet gave light enough to discern a body. And indeed, this was one especial disadvantage to the king's army, for the Romans coming upon them with the moon on their backs, the moon being very low and just upon setting, cast the shadows a long way before their bodies, reaching almost to the enemy, whose eyes were thus so much deceived that not exactly discerning the distance, they threw their darts at the shadows without the least execution. What a sight! Romans charging you. That's gotta be scary to see an enemy charging, backlit by a setting moon with their shadows reaching all the way towards you, such that you can't even aim at them. And from the Roman perspective, the moon behind you setting off the face of your enemy and you running over their spears lying on the ground in front of you as you charge. What a vision that must have turned to memory in the mind's eye of everyone who fought that battle. It's fun to imagine it. 10,000 were slain. Mithridates escaped. Now let's read about where Pompey goes next. He gives up on Mithridates for the time being because it is irritating to chase one man all across the countryside. And so instead he turns to these other kingdoms. Mithridates ultimately will kill himself when his son rebels against him. From here, Pompey marches into the Caucasus, where there are several nations that he is going to have to deal with. Of these, the Albanians and Iberians were the two chiefest. The Iberians stretch out as far as the Moschian Mountains and the Pontus. The Albanians lie more eastwardly towards the Caspian Sea. So Pompey defeats the Albanians over the course of two battles. He beats them once, and then he finds out that they revolt, and so he marches on them again to the River Abyss, where he fights them. And here's the description of these Albanians. Ill-armed, generally, and most of them covered only with the skins of wild beasts. Okay, so this is he presents them as a barbarian army, rumored to be fighting alongside Amazons. And as they're taking the spoils and plunder of the field, Plutarch says that they met with several targets and buskins of the Amazons, but no woman's body was found among the dead. And then he writes further that there's a rumor that Amazons mingle with them for 2 months out of the year, and then they go back to their own habitations. So it seems like a little bit of semi-legend is managing to pass to Plutarch. There's a further note. There's something about the order in which Plutarch does this that I don't know why I can't resist speculating about this. Of the concubines of King Mithridates, he starts this paragraph in the middle of this march into the Caspian Sea area, that of the concubines of King Mithridates that were brought before Pompey, he took none to himself, but sent them all away to their parents and relations, most of them being either the daughters or wives of princes and great commanders. Isn't this a strange place to pop this in? The only reason for it to occur to Plutarch to put this here is if the sources that he read told him that this was the correct location to release those concubines. And if this was the correct location to release those concubines here in the Caucasus Mountains, then it follows that that's where they were acquired in the first place. So we have a king, Mithridates, who is seizing women from the Caucasus Mountains. I just wonder if there's a general history of beautiful women in this area and they get snatched. I wonder if that still happens. Is this an area that just gets raided for it? I'm going to read some. These are lines from the Marquis de Sade, who knows a thing or two about sex trafficking.
These are the words of Monsieur de Nuance.
The Megrelians and Georgians are renowned for being the most beautiful races on earth, and simultaneously for being the most addicted to every sort of luxury and crime. 'Tis quite as if nature had contrived thus to advise us that far from being displeased by this misbehavior, she wished to lavish all her gifts upon those with whom it was most positively chronic. For de Sade to use the word renowned, talking about the Mingrelians and the Georgians, right? So these are people who are right in this Caucasus area. For him to use the word renowned, in what circles is this renowned? I've never heard of this. Have you? You don't find this in Voltaire and in Molière. You don't find it in Goethe. Who repeats this renown of the Georgians and Mingrelians? It begs the question, did the Marquis de Sade come across such a reputation in nefarious markets? Has it always been the case? But most interesting is to say this, because we've been talking about ever since the life of Sulla, we're coming across a period of history that, for all the risk that we take whenever we melodramatically refer to periods as being turning points, we know what is coming as we close out this Pompey video, because we know what is about to happen with Caesar, but we also know that big changes sometimes have small beginnings, and it's fascinating to see that it is as an afterthought. It barely matters. As Plutarch tells us in four words, he conquered also Judea, right? And we know this happens in the year 63 BC. Pompey takes Judea and Jerusalem. This is a moment in history without which the rest is impossible. Pompey returns with a massive triumph. The king of Judea in chains. But more than that, as Plutarch describes this triumph for Pompey, we get some sense of the scale of his accomplishments. As he writes, the splendor and magnificence of Pompey's triumph was such that, though it took up the space of 2 days, yet they were extremely straitened in time. It was difficult for them to get to everything, is what Plutarch is telling us. What they did get to, let us see here in these words. In the first place, there were tables carried, inscribed with the names and titles of the nations over whom he triumphed. Pontus, Armenia, Cappadocia, Paphlagonia, Media, Colchis, the Iberians and the Albanians, Syria, Cilicia, and Mesopotamia, together with Phoenicia and Palestine, Judea, Arabia, and all the power of the pirates subdued by sea and land. And in these countries, there appeared the capture of no less than 1,000 fortified places, nor much less than 900 cities, together with 800 ships of the pirates, and the foundation of 39 towns. Then he goes on to say that these conquests added to the revenue of Rome in total from 50 million to 85 million. This is the scale of Pompey's triumph.
And it has to be wondered if this is the etymological origin for the word pomp. It's an awful coincidence if it's not. But unfortunately, for the Roman Republic, it is all downhill from here. Because shortly after this, Caesar is going to return from Gaul. And the stage is going to be set with this first triumvirate in 59 BC for what will eventually be the first Roman emperor